morning. I adjust my glasses now. I can see. Glad you're here. Please look to your bulletin for some announcements, and I'm going to touch a couple of things, if I may. Choir this afternoon for the program, and that is September the 17th. Please keep that on your calendar and be looking for that. For the choir practice Wednesday night, you notice Ladies Bible Study, Promise Keepers, and Children's Church. They're meeting in the new Ocean Room today. Hope y'all wore proper attire for going to the ocean. I don't know. Happy birthdays this week. I saw her coming in this morning, and I asked her about birthday. Alyssa's got one on the 17th. Evelyn Jones has one on the 18th. And there's more coming this month. This is a busy month for our family. My son, my daughter, and me all have birthdays during this month. So busy times. Last Sunday worship, 81. That's good, but we're continuing to grow in that, and I'm thankful for that. Note here that Brother Darrell will be on WZOB this week.
Thanks for the reminder.
Yes. I thought that was...
Yeah,
that was
I'm always afraid I'll forget that.
Yeah, I thought that was
good. I got the face for radio.
Yeah, I thought that was good because he's preaching this morning and he's just going to take that and spread it out all. No, I'm kidding. He's not going to do that. I'm kidding. He'll have mixed thoughts every day. I suppose. For the joy of the Lord is your strength, and we laugh and cut up with each other quite often. Notice also this little flyer inside. I'm not going to take the time to read that, but please do so. Special event next Sunday afternoon at 2. There are a couple of cards here. Do you want me to read these?
If you
want to,
if you will.
Okay. This is a thank you. Dear church family, once again, John and I have come to thank all that called or sent cards to me and all the prayers during my recovery time. So thankful for our church family. The Lord has blessed us on high. Thank you so much for your thoughtfulness, love in Christ, John and Veronica Beer. If you did not hear, my understanding is that all her tests came back negative.
Amen.
Good to see her here again this morning. I don't know how you feel about this, but we've had some near misses quite often lately about the weather. And I've been asking people in the choir to pray. And we had, Ken and my wife, we had 13 praying on last Sunday afternoon. No, it wasn't that Sunday. It was Monday when it was supposed to be so bad. And it came below and above us. So I appreciate those who prayed during that time. We did not get the worst of that. Wednesday we had another close call with that, but I do believe in the power of prayer, and that's one way that the Lord has answered those prayers this week. Appreciate that very much. Anyone else have an announcement before I? Notice too, if you will, that whenever Brother John is not speaking, some Sundays I just call on him to do special music, so he'll be bringing special music for us today, remembering him in that, and Brother Darrell as he brings the message. Anyone else? Okay, let's bow in prayer, and then we'll begin to sing. Dear Lord, we pause to thank you for your presence with us. We ask that we would strive to honor you and glorify you with all that we do, all that we sing, all that we speak. May our thoughts be in line with what you would have us to think. Lord, there are so many that we lift up to you this morning. And as I pray, I ask that others would be praying as well, lifting up those who have been mentioned with sickness, with COVID around us again. Those who've lost loved ones, Lord, we pray a special blessing on them. Help us through this service, Lord, to lift you up. Be with Brother John as he sings. Be with Brother Darrell as he brings your message. The choir as they sing. Congregation, all those who are behind the scenes, pushing buttons, twisting knobs, playing instruments, thank you so much for your dedication to you. Thank you for your love to us above all, Lord, and forgive us where we fail you, we pray in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Would you stand as we sing Praise Him, Praise Him?
Praise Him, praise Him. Jesus, our blessed Redeemer. Sing, O Lord.
singing the We're the Family of God to the same tune as We Have Come Into His House. We'll be in tune with this if you've not sung it before.
We're the family of God.
They said, I believe the next 24 hours are going to be very important for him. He began with a UTI and developed into shutting down his kidneys and things. So Brother Layman needs our prayers greatly. So please be much in prayer for him. Brother Larry is going to the doctor tomorrow, Larry, in Chattanooga, Tuesday, to get set up for his surgical procedure. So remember him. I know many others. There's so many things we need to pray about, but I want to especially mention those to you. And also ask you to pray. Collinsville Nursing Home has a severe outbreak of COVID going on. I do plan to go see Pat this afternoon. Please pray for me. I will mask up and wash up and do everything I can to be safe. But I do need to go see her. I did go this week. And please keep them in your prayers and all the staff down there. I understand yesterday that one individual, possibly two, that have come home from rehab came home with COVID. So it's a very serious time. We need to be prayerful about that. Thank you.
I have an update on my sister-in-law, Deb Cover. She's had bone cancer, and they said the bone cancer is gone now, but it's in her liver, so. And I don't know if it's in her brain or not, but she still needs our prayers. Please keep her on our prayer list. Deb Cover.
I think we should pray for those people in Hawaii who
yes.
lost everything.
Yes.
I mean, absolutely have nothing left.
Definitely.
Yes.
Thank you.
Yes.
Kinsley Mitchell, she was in a coma. She went to the coma in December. She woke up, but they had to take her foot, and she was at school on Monday. The first day of school, and I haven't seen she left since we let out early. She hasn't been back, and I'm worried because we think her family took away her phone, and we don't know what's going on because nobody can get in contact with her.
Thank you.
I didn't recognize you to start with. No, that's probably his. Please. Kids have now become youth and they've grown up without us and don't even recognize them, some of them.
Yes, sir.
First of all, I think it's really great to see these young people sitting all together over there. Also, there's a young man by the name of Charlie, and I don't know Charlie's last name. If you know Jimmy Black, he's Jimmy Black's brother-in-law, or son, yeah, brother-in-law. He has stomach cancer, it's inoperable. He's at the hospital over in Birmingham, and I don't know what they expect out of it, but we sure have a lot of people praying for him, just like we had praying for my lovely wife. So prayer, God answers prayers. And so let's pray for Charlie today as well.
Let me add to that list. I don't know exactly what's going on with her. She had severe abdominal pain a couple of days ago, and then that turned into just hurting all over. There is some sort of stomach bug going around. I think Anna has now. I don't know if it's the same thing or what. She's better. Good. So a lot of sickness around us. Please remember those around us. Yes.
My brother has the prostate cancer, and they are finally doing surgery Friday. And he's scared to death. Scared really bad. So I just pray, ask that you pray for him. Let's pray for his salvation.
If you wonder why our musicians are congregating around the front still, it's because Brother John's going to sing and they're going to play for him in a few minutes.
God, I gotta get
up. Amen.
Just remember, I say amen, you too.
Anyone else? Brother John, would you lead us in our prayer?
Oh, excuse me, I'm sorry. Unspoken request. Thank you.
Would you pray with me? My gracious Heavenly Father, though we don't deserve it, we just count it a privilege to be able to come before the throne of grace this morning. Now, there's lots of prayer requests that have gone up for cancer and for salvation. God, more than any disease, I pray for those ones, Father, that are at the doorsteps of hell. Father, I pray that you would touch their hearts. You bring them to that place of personal salvation, that they might grow in the Lord. God, we thank you for what you're doing in our midst. We thank you for the young people that are in our church today. And I just praise you for them sitting together and being in the worship service. We thank you for that. God, we thank you for what you're doing in our midst. We ask you to continue it. Just bless us from on high. We pray that you just bless the speaker this morning. God, we're looking for a positive message that might speak to our hearts this morning. And we'll be careful to give you the praise with thanksgiving for all of it. In Jesus' name, we always pray. Amen.
You know, I want you to do me a favor before I sing this morning. I want you, if you can get your hand on one of these red-back church hymnals, please take it and open it to number 110. That's not what I'm singing right now, but I want you to have it there. When we worship the Lord, there are a lot of different expressions of our worship to Him. Sometimes our worship is very loud and very expressive. Sometimes it's a little more calm and a little more soothing, maybe. The song I want to try to share with you this morning talks about how the Lord has been in my life since I've been a Christian. And I love this song because I found out the older I get, the further I go as a believer in Jesus Christ, the sweeter that relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ goes. So you pray for me this morning as I try to share it the longer I serve.
Since I started
You know, he works, and I know me and you didn't even talk about this morning, but you'll find out how that song that you sang just fit right in with what I'm going to talk about. And I tell you what, guys, if you have not ever sat up here in front of this choir and heard them sing and hear them sing all their parts and everything, I would encourage you to do it. Sometimes not everybody will sing Sunday morning. I wouldn't recommend that. But that choir, they did a great job. Jerry does a great job with them. And I would love for you to give the choir another hand. Jerry, thank you. And Donna, thank you for your piano playing this morning. And thank you. I don't know if they called them the praise band or the ragtime band. But they sound pretty doggone good, you know what? They do a great job. Let's give everybody a hand that's involved in this. Because I know that just doesn't happen. There's a lot of work that goes along behind that and everything. And so and I was coming down from teaching the youth Sunday school class, and I was a little bit confused because I heard the praise band out here playing, and I heard the choir in the choir room practicing, but all I could hear was music and singing, and I was thinking, man, they're way off from the music. They ain't nowhere close to being together, you know? And I happened to remember, hey, the choir's practicing in that room, so. I appreciate all the work that they do. If you would, this morning, turn to Joshua chapter 1. Joshua chapter 1. I want to speak to you this morning about Joshua, a spiritual leader for his generation. Joshua, a spiritual leader for his generation. I come down to the office the other day and I need Donnie, do you think that I didn't come to work Friday?
That you need to come to work Friday?
No, I just wondered if you wondered if I come to work the last year of Friday because I didn't call you and need you to do something for me.
Yeah,
I think about every day that I've been here, I have called Donna and said, Donna, will you do this for me? You know, and so I appreciate every, and she is there volunteering. And she is videoing our sermon for us this morning, and she does it nearly just for Vicki Brown, don't she? And we appreciate it. And I thank Donna for all. Let's give Donna a hand. And she does a lot of stuff in the office, behind the scenes, that a lot of people don't know, and I'm going to keep her busy. But the other day I did come in the office, and John was sitting there, with Donna, and they was discussing some stuff, and John said, would you want to preach for me one Sunday? I said, yeah, I'd love to. And he said, when would you like to? And I said, well, you just tell me when. And he told me when. So after he gave me a date, he looked at me and said, would you like to borrow a good sermon? I said, how good is it? He said, I'd say it's pretty doggone good. So I said, yeah, I said, let me borrow one. So he gave me one, and two or three days later, we was down here at church, and he said, Brother Darrell, he said, you've been able to look at that sermon? I said, I sure have. He said, what do you think about it? I said, well, I looked at the introduction, and I changed some things a lot. I looked at the 4 points that you had, and they were good. But then again, I also changed them a lot. And I read the conclusion of your sermon, and he said, what do you think about that? He said, well, I liked it. I said, but I changed it too, a lot. So one of these days, I'm able to preach that sermon and maybe the altar be full. But I appreciate him offering anyway, but it is good to be back home. At Midvale Baptist Church. Man, it's been 15 and a half years, and it has been a joy to be back. up at the Life Center and to be back at church and to be with you and be worshiping you with you. And it's just me and Nina are just blessed. This is our third trip back. We was raised here as youth and got married here, had our kids here. Now we're calling to the ministry here. We left and moved to Kentucky. We come back, spent 10 years at the Life Center with Brother Alton Vaughn, and then we left and went to Valley Head Baptist Church and stayed 15 and a half years, and now we're back. So it's a joy to be back. I know a lot of you probably think, well, you was at the Life Center for 10 years at one time. Coming back ought to be easy for you. But you know, reality, it's not that easy to do. First of all, a lot of Life Center ministry has changed. It used to be recreation and sports 100%. And now a lot of people are using their using their Life Centers for sports, but they're also using them for Bible classes and discipleship classes and services and that sort of thing. Second thing, I've been pastoring for the last 15 and a half years. And Brother Ronnie and Brother John and Katie, you know, your priorities are different. Your mindset's a little bit different when you're pastoring. So my mindset for the last 15 years has been on pastoring. And then thirdly, the most important thing is that's God's Life Center. It's not the Bell Baptist Church's Life Center. It's not your Life Center. It's not my Life Center. That is God's. To be used for His glory, His honor, His mission, His purpose. And that Life Center is a God-sized task. And what I mean by God-sized task is that if anything good spiritually or eternally happens at Bell Baptist Church Life Center, it ain't going to be Brother Darrell that does it. It's going to be God.
Amen.
So I see it as an awesome task to come back and be able to just dedicate it back to God and give it back to God and give Him all the glory and honor for it. But as I do, I want to go back to a passage of Scripture that really means a lot to me, and that is Joshua chapter 1, verses 1 through 9. This passage of Scripture encourages me a lot, gives me a lot of assurance, gives me a lot of hope. Because Joshua was at a very important point in his life. Because look at verse 1 and 2. After the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord, it came to pass that the Lord spoke to Joshua, the son of Nun, Moses' assistant, saying, Moses, my servant, is dead. Now therefore, arise and go over this Jordan, and you and all these people, to the land which I am given to them, the children of Israel. Here we see God approaching Moses and him telling Moses, approaching Joshua and telling him, my servant Moses has died. Now you got to understand who Moses is to the children of Israel. He was the thing. He was the top dog. With the children of Israel, God was 1A and Moses was 1B. And there were times in the life of the children of Israel that Moses was probably up above God when it comes to the children of Israel. So Moses is a highly respected. Now, it didn't start out that right way. If you know your Bible, Moses first went, what did he do? He killed the Egyptian. And he buried him. And the Israelite people found out about it and said, well, now you're going to go ahead and kill us? His ministry with the children of Israel did not start out very good. But God was calling Joshua to be the next spiritual leader of the children of Israel. And he was going to follow in the footsteps of Moses. Now just imagine how Joshua felt when what God was calling Joshua to that position. Let me give you a real life example, okay? Suppose one night, Brother John, he's about half asleep in his recliner. And he's watching a Western and sipping on a glass of tea. Did y'all know that Brother John loves Westerns? He does. If you go to Brother John's house and you visit him, I bet there'll be a Western playing on his TV. I bet if you reach down and grab the remote and you flip it on ESPN, you know what's going to be playing on Brother John's TV? A Western. Every channel on his TV is playing a Western because Brother John loves them. Suppose he's half asleep and the phone rings and Brother John picks it up and says, hello. And the person on the other end says, is this Brother John Keefe, the pastor of Midville Baptist Church? He said, why, yes it is. What can I do for you? He says, I am Brother John Ross. I'm the pastor search committee of the First Baptist Church, Atlanta, Georgia. As you may know, as anybody knows, our beloved pastor, Charles Stanley, has just passed away. And we have heard about you and looked up you, and we have found out some information about you. And the pastor search committee has discussed this. And the trustees have discussed it. And we have talked to the church, and they believe that you might be qualified to be the next pastor of First Baptist Church, Atlanta, Georgia. Well, all of a sudden, there is a thump, and Anna just happens to be there. And she picks up the phone and says, if you mind, hold on just a second. My dad has just passed out. He's laying in the floor. He's fixing to get up. I think you're going to be okay. So, Brother John picks the phone back up and he says, the pastor of First Baptist Church, Atlanta, Georgia, you're asking me to come and follow Brother Darrell Haney? Yes, sir. We believe you're the man to do it. And you pray about it. And if you think that God has laid on your heart to come and pastor our big old church over here, Atlanta, Georgia, we will have a jet airplane in Fort Payne, Alabama, at an airport to get you and your wife Monday morning. Brother John passes out again. Well, now you know how Joshua felt. Joshua, I'm choosing you, and I'm calling you to be the next spiritual leader of the children of Israel to follow Moses. Now I want you to notice something about this. I want you to notice the response of Joshua. Look at verse 10. After it's all said and done, and God has told him everything that he's going to tell him, look what Joshua does in verse 10. Everybody look there. Okay, look down at your Bibles and look at verse 10 because you need to read this. Then Joshua commanded the officers of the Bible, saying, pass through the camp and command the people, saying, prepare provisions for yourselves, for within 3 days you will cross over the Jordan, going to possess the land which the Lord your God is giving you possess. What was Joshua's response to God saying, I want you to follow and be the leader of the children of Israel? Do you hear any excuses why he can't do it? Do you hear any reasons? Do you hear Joshua say, God, I can't do that, or God, I won't do that. Do you hear that from him? You don't. He's not like Jeremiah. Jeremiah said, God, I can't do that. I'm just a youth. He's not like Isaiah. Isaiah told him, he said, listen, Isaiah. Isaiah told God, he said, God, I'm a person of unclean lips. I come from a people of unclean lips. I can't do it. What did Moses do when God called him to come and join him in the mission to bring his people out of Egypt? Five excuses that Moses gave God. I can't do it. But not Joshua. Joshua never one time says, God, I can't do it. God, I won't do it. He's like those early disciples when Jesus came and said, follow me, come and follow me, and I'll make you fishers of men. And the Bible says they immediately laid everything down and followed. That's what Joshua did. He said, Joshua, he said, God, he said, I don't think I can do this. I don't think I have the ability and the capability to do it. But God, I trust you. God, I put my faith in you. And God, I know I can't do it, but God, I know that you can do it through me. And Joshua said, yes, I will. John chapter 15, Jesus tells us two times, you cannot do anything without me. Nothing, zero, zip. You can do nothing without me. But then Philippians 4:13, what does it say? You can do all things through Christ who strengthens you. And man, that's what Joshua's doing. And after Joshua agreed to do what God had called him to do, God began to give him some assurances. I want to share some of these with you real quickly. First of all, look, if you will, in verse 2. Moses, my servant, is dead. Now therefore arise and go over to Jordan, you and all the people, to the land which I have given to them, the children of Israel, for every place that the sole of your feet will tread upon, I have given you, as I said to Moses. What was the promise that God gave Moses and the children of Israel about the promised land? It's yours. I've already deeded it over to you. I'm not going to wait till you get there to give it to you. It's already yours. All you got to do in faith and obedience is go and claim it. And God gave Moses promise after promise after promise after promise. And guess what he tells Joshua here? Every promise that I ever give to my servant Moses, I am giving you the same promises. Amen. Every one of them. If you heard me give them to Moses, I'm giving them to you right now. Everything I promised and guaranteed Moses that I would do in his ministry as he led the children of Israel, I will do in your ministry also as you lead the children of Israel. Every promise. Do you know that there is 8,810 promises in the Bible? 8,810 promises in the Bible. And do you know that every one of those promises are yours and mine? When God calls you, he calls you out to be a spiritual leader. Every one of those 8,000 promises belong to you. God guarantees them on his eternal name that they're yours. Look at the second thing that he tells Joshua. Second thing that he told him, look at verse 5. No man shall be able to stand before you all the days of your life. As I was with Moses, so I will be with you. I will not leave you nor forsake you. And then look at verse 9, if you will. Have I not commanded you to be strong and of good courage? And do not be afraid nor dismayed, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. Second promise he gave to Joshua, he says, just as I was with Moses, Joshua, I will be with you. Do you think that Joshua knew God had been with Moses? I think he was there and seen it with his own very eyes. The day that Moses was standing there with his staff and Pharaoh's magicians were there with their two staffs and they threw them down on the ground. And what did they become? They become snakes. What did Moses do? He threw his one staff down and it became a snake and his one staff ate those two snakes. Joshua witnessed that. All the plagues, the 10 plagues that God gave Moses, that the one Pharaoh about, that God was going to put on Egyptian people until they let his people go. Joshua saw every one of those 10 plagues come true. Every one of them. Joshua was there when Moses, the children of Israel, was standing at the Red Sea. The Red Sea in front of them, Pharaoh and his army behind them. What were they going to do? God told Moses, stand up and hold up your staff and watch the salvation of the Lord. And he did it. And the Bible says that the winds parted the Red Sea and the children of Israel walked across on dry land. And when Pharaoh and his army got there, the water came in on. He saw God with Moses all the way through it. And God was telling Joshua, just as I was with Moses, I will be with you. You know, when God called Moses to go to Pharaoh and command him to let God's people go, Moses asked God, he said, God, who I say sent me? He said, tell them that the great I am sent you. And you know what God was telling Moses that? He's telling Moses the same thing he's telling you and I. When we step out in faith and we step out in obedience and we serve God, he was promising Moses that all of me is going to be with you. Everything in heaven, everything in earth, everything that relates to me, everything that makes me up, my character, my nature, my thoughts, my ways, my faithfulness, my power, my all knowledge, everything, it's going to be available to you. It's going to be yours as you go and do what I've called and asked you to do. Just remember, when God calls you out, he's got a purpose for your life, and he's got a ministry in front of you for you that he wants you to do. And you're a little bit hesitant about saying yes. Just remember that God is telling you today, like he told Moses, hey, you're going to have all of me. I'm not going to hold nothing back. Man, that ought to encourage us to step out in faith and obedience every time if we know we've got all God. What did Jesus tell the disciples in Matthew chapter 28? Before he told them to go and make disciples, he said, all power in heaven and earth belong to me. He was telling those disciples, he was telling the church, all power in heaven and on earth. All power in heaven and earth is going to be available to you. as you go and make disciples. I want you to notice something else that he did. First thing he told them, look at verse 9. He said, have I not commanded you to be strong? What does it mean to be strong? Now, we're talking about God calling us out to be spiritual leaders. God's calling us out to be involved maybe in the ministry of church or the ministry of God's kingdom. He's telling Joshua here, he said, first of all, be strong. What does it mean to be strong? To stand firm. To have a strong resolve. To not be swayed one way or the other. To not turn to the left or the right from God and His ways and His word. Always following the path of righteousness and holiness that God has laid in front of you. And then he tells Joshua, he said, be courageous. What does it mean to be courageous? What's the difference between being strong and being courageous? Well, being courageous means to be spiritually daring. To spiritually step out in complete faith. To totally and completely be obedient, even when you can't see the complete picture and see how it's going to turn out, you still obey God. Even though you cannot see the whole puzzle put together, that God has put together, you still obey God. Even if you had to stand in faith all alone, on your own, all by yourself, you still step out in faith. So he commanded him, he said, be strong. And then be courageous. Be spiritually daring. I love what somebody said one time about stepping out in faith is stepping out in faith is like you're standing on the edge of darkness and you can't see nothing to step out on. And God is asking you in faith to step out. And when you step out in faith, you believe one of two things is going to happen. Either God is going to give you something to step on, or God's going to give you wings to fly.
Amen.
Listen, when God calls you to step out in the unknown, and you step out in faith for Him, I promise you, He will not let you fall. His promises will be with you and His presence will be with you. And then he tells them, he said, do not be afraid. The total opposite of faith is to be afraid. The fear of people, the fear of rejection, the fear of the world, the fear of what people think about you. You know, fear can do some crazy things to you. And here he's telling Joshua, he said, Don't fear. Don't be afraid. But then he takes it a step further, like he did with being strong and courageous, and he said, do not be dismayed. What does that mean? It means to be spiritually overwhelmed. It means to be completely discouraged. To be completely defeated spiritually. To totally doubt God. It means to be spiritually paralyzed. To want to give up and quit. To throw in the towel on God. To walk away spiritually from God. When you're spiritually dismayed and you finally come to the point that you doubt God, man, you're spiritually in trouble. God didn't want Joshua to be there. Now, why did he tell him to be strong and courageous? And why did he tell him not to be afraid and dismayed? Joshua's going to need it, wasn't he? He's going to need it. Man, you know who led the children of Israel. Man, you know those Baptist people in the Old Testament, they just, I'm sorry, not Baptist. The children of Israel. I got Baptist children of Israel. You know, all they did was grumble and cry, gripe and complain. Here God was. He was about to split the Red Sea for them. What'd you do, Moses? Did you bring us out here so the Egyptians could kill us? He was going to need these commandments to be strong and courageous, not be afraid, not be dismayed. There's going to be times when leading the children of Israel was going to be so tough that he was going to doubt his own calling, that he was going to doubt God's promises, that he was going to doubt God's presence. And he was going to have to be strong and courageous and not afraid or dismayed. There's going to be times as he led the children of Israel that he was going to have to make decisions, and he just didn't know what decision to make. Man, he had to be strong and courageous. And he couldn't fear it, he couldn't be dismayed. You see, God knew as he led the children of Israel, he was going to have to need those commandments. And then the last thing as we finish up. About done, y'all. If you would, look at verse 7. Only be strong and very courageous, that you may observe to do according to the law which Moses, my servant, commanded you. Do not turn from it to the right hand or to the left, that you may prosper wherever you go. This book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate in it day and night, that you may observe to do according to all that is written in it. For then you will make your way prosperous, and then you will have good success. What was God telling Joshua here? He's telling the last commandment I'm giving you is to obey my word. Obey it. It's not the least commandment. It's probably the most important one, but it was the last one. He wanted Joshua to remember. God commanded Joshua to totally and completely obey his law. Not 80%, not 90%, not 99.9%, but 100% follow and obey God's word. To obey his commandments. Even when he didn't understand. Even when he didn't know what God was talking about. Joshua, obey me. Just obey me. Put your faith in me. Just obey me, Joshua, and everything will be okay. You'll be spiritually prosperous. Can you imagine Joshua and the children of Israel? They come to the city of Jericho. A city so fortified, so strong, that the mightiest armies in all the land could not defeat it. And there it was between them and the promised land. God says, this is my commandment to you. The first 6 days, I want you to walk around the city of Jericho one time. One time, just one time, that's all I want you to do. Walk around it one time. And then on day 7, what I want you to do is I want you to walk around it 7 times. And I want you to shout to the Lord, and I want you to sing your trumpets, and I want you to praise me, and the walls will come falling down. What if God had given us that commandment? We would have never said anything. You know, you remember when you were little, and your mom and dad told you something, and you thought they'd done lost their rockers. You know, they'd done lost their mind. You didn't say anything to them. You knew better. Thought they was going crazy. Don't you think that Joshua and the children of Israel thought, God, how in the world are you going to march around a fortified city like this and conquer it? And Joshua remembered, obey my word. Don't go to the left, don't go to the right. told Obed, and he turned to the children of Israel, we're going to do exactly what God told us to do. They did exactly what God commanded them to do, and the walls of the city fell. And the city of Jericho was theirs. Man, oh man, don't you know that Joshua and the children of Israel at that moment should have had an eternal impression on their hearts and their minds right there. I ain't never going to disobey God again. If he could tell us to march around the city that many times and the walls fall, I'm going to obey him at all times. What did God tell Joshua? If you will obey me, you will prosper. You will be successful. You'll experience my blessings. You'll experience things that I can do through you that you can never do on your own. Never do on your own. That was the promise. This is way over in Joshua, over in Old Testament. But you know what? That promise is the same for me and you.
Amen.
He said, if you obey me, if you not compromise my word, if you'll not water it down, if you'll not add gray areas, we've got so many gray areas in God's word now. We know the difference between right and wrong, but we look at situations and say, well, you know, it's their life. If they think it's okay to do, well, then, you know, let them do it. I'm not going to say anything. We as a church today has allowed a lot of gray areas to come in God's word. God will bless that. You know what he blesses? He blesses total and complete obedience. And when you totally and completely obey God, you experience what God can do through you and not what you can do. In Joshua chapter 24, verse 15, we're very familiar with that. When Joshua stood before the children of Israel, he said, you have got to decide who you will serve. But as for me and my house, Brother John, we're going to serve the Lord. You do whatever you want to do. But I've experienced too much God to turn back on God. And whatever God calls me to be, whatever God calls me to do, I'm going to trust God and put my faith in God and obey him and do it. I don't know what he's calling you to do. I don't know what ministry in the church he's calling you to do today. I don't know what ministry in his kingdom he's calling you to do. I don't know your relationship with God. But I can tell you this, if God chooses you and God calls you, he equips you and he empowers you. And he promises his promises to you and his presence to be with you. Joshua drew the line in the sand and said, God, I'm going to serve you. Will you do the same today? I've asked Brother Weston to play a video for us today, so if you would, look up at the screen.
I believe he rose up from the dead, alive for all to see. That is why, oh, the more I will serve him. I have made my decision. I have staked my claim. I have drawn a line in the sand, and I'll not be ashamed. With the world behind me and the cross before, by the grace of God, I will serve the Lord. I believe you must be born again. John 3:16 is true. The old life can be washed away. Everything made new.
Stand to our feet, and I'm going to ask you to come out of invitation.